Om Sahana Vavatu Sahana Bhunaktu Sahavirjam Karavavahai Tejasvinavadhitamastu Mavidvishavahai Om Shanti 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 Om, may Brahman protect us, may he guide us, may he give us strength and right understanding, may love and harmony be with us all. Om, peace, peace, peace. Happy Easter. Today, because of Easter, I have chosen a subject, resurrection according to Vedanta. So let us recount the story of resurrection of Lord Jesus Christ. The story is like this, that Jesus Christ was coming to spend the Passover in Jerusalem, coming from Bethany side, that means from Galilee side. And on the way near Bethany, he heard the death of one of his well-known devotees, brother Lazarus. He died, and so he went to the house of Lazarus' sisters, Martha and Mary, and there he heard that Martha Mary said that if you had come 4 days ago, Lazarus would not have died, you could have saved him. So then they tried, then they cried, and Jesus Christ said that, well, let me see, that means where is the body kept, or has been cremated. Cremated means buried. So they took him to that place of burial, and Jesus Christ prayed, and afterwards said, Lazarus, come out, come out. In that way he said, and Lazarus actually, he was dead 4 days ago and came out of the grave. And everybody was surprised. Surprise means they are beyond words. And that miracle that he showed, or that happened, spread like a wildfire. He was showing, or many miracles were really spreading. So the Jews, those Orthodox Jews, they are very much apprehensive of Jesus Christ's teaching. And he often said that, I am Son of God, and I shall come back as King of Kings. All those words frightened the Jewish priests. So they are trying to subdue him. So after this incident, Jesus Christ came to the house of Martha and Mary, and naturally they are overjoyed getting back their brother. And naturally they treated him very well, and he was his feet were washed, and some perfume was used for that. But the point is this, Jesus Christ was moving with a group of his disciples also. 12 disciples were there, and one of the disciples, his name Judah, so he was very much upset because so much money is being spent for treating Jesus Christ, especially perfumes and all those things. He said that this money could have been used for the feeding of poor people, that so much money was not necessary for the treatment of Jesus Christ. So he became a little upset, but Jesus replied that, well, they will not get, that means the devotees, Martha and Mary, will not get in future the chance of treating me the way they are treating now. So that was the first sign, we can say, that he will live. He has decided not to live too long. So after this treatment, the entourage started moving towards Jerusalem, and people thronged behind him because the news spread, of Lazarus' coming back to life spread like anything. So there was a huge crowd behind him, and they started shouting. And in that way they came. So the priests were really trying to find out something by which they can really get rid of him. So Judas actually knew that, so he confided with the Jewish priest that if you give me some money, I can really help you in your, what is called, in your project, if you call it. That means I can help you and get so that you can get rid of Jesus Christ or whatever it may be. So in that way he promised him, and he was given money. And the arrangements were like that he will be arrested at some point by the priests of Jewish priest, and they had their sentries, and the arrangement was like that. When Jesus Christ will go in a secluded place for prayer and all those things, then they will come, Judas will come with them, and they will show him that this is Jesus Christ, and they will arrest him and bring to the priests. That means in the synagogue he will be brought, and they will point blank ask him whether he has said this and he thinks that he is Son of God. All those things they will ask. So it so happened that was Passover, so there was a Passover supper, and in that supper the disciples were there, and while they were eating, Jesus Christ said that one of you will betray me. And in fact, Judas at that time, he left saying that he has some errand to do, and went to the priest and said that I shall take you to that place where Jesus Christ is going. So after the supper, Jesus Christ went to the mount which is known as Gethsemane with three disciples, and the purpose was to pray, because that was a Passover time, so it was a time for prayer. So he prayed with the disciples, and he prayed so intensely, it is said that blood started oozing out from his head and face. But in the meantime, those disciples actually slept, they did not pray. So Jesus was very surprised, and he scolded them, and at that time Judas appeared with a few sentries of the Jews. And the sentries did not know who is Jesus among the four persons present there. So Judas actually greeted Jesus Christ with a kiss, and that was the arrangement. That means the person who will be kissed, he will be Jesus Christ. So in that way, when he was kissed, the sentries actually arrested him and brought him in to the court of those priests. And the priest was very angry, and they point blank asked, are you son of God? So Jesus Christ with full strength said that, yes, I am Son of God. Do you think that you are King of Kings? He said that, yes, he confirmed that. But they did not understand from what point of view he was replying, and from what point of view were they asking. So then they said that, well, the punishment that we can give to a Jew, that means he was a Jew, so naturally he said that we can really imprison you. But because you are you're blasphemous, that you are claiming that you are God, so that is subject to death sentence. But they did not have the power to give death sentence. So they took him to the court of the governor. That means at that time Jerusalem was governed by the Romans. So Roman governor was there, and they took him to that court and said that this person is very dangerous, and he said that he's King of Kings, that he wants to overthrow this Roman kingdom. So all those things they arranged, and they said that he's a subject of death sentence. That means he should be hanged, or he should be put to the cross. In those days, actually, they used to execute the what is called prisoners, those who are condemned to death on a cross. So they claimed that. But this governor understood the ploy. That means he understood that they want to get rid of this person, and they had such a great support that he could not do anything. So to avoid this, just to give a chance to Jesus, to release Jesus Christ, he said that, well, this is the Passover time. On this particular time, I release one of the prisoners who had been condemned to death. So I have a prisoner, his name is Barabbas. And do you think that I shall, instead of Barabbas, I release Jesus Christ from the death sentence? So they said, no, we want Jesus Christ to be crucified. So there is no other way that he could save him. So ultimately he was ordered to be put under the cross. And we see that from that place he went to the place where the cross is, that means they are crucified. So Jesus Christ, and there were other two thieves also who were condemned to death. So all those three persons went, the three prisoners, if you call, they went carrying their own cross. That means they are so heavy that it is said that Jesus Christ fell down and wounded him, but somehow he reached there in the Calvary, that Mount Calvary, and there the cross was erected. Then he was nailed by the sentries of the governor, and in that way the drama was finished. And at that time we see that his disciples and his relatives all were present. His mother was also there. And from the cross, actually, Jesus Christ said that one of his disciples named John, after his passing away, John, he told his mother that after my death, John will be my substitute. That means he will be taking care of you, and you can treat him as your son. So by saying all those things, people dispersed, and it takes time because the blood and water and all those things started oozing. So around afternoon, actually, he left his body. That means when he was in cross, those two thieves, one of them actually understood who was Jesus Christ. He said that when you go to the paradise, please remember me also. So Jesus Christ said, assured him that, yes, I shall remember you. So his last words were that, that those who purported to kill him, he said that please pray to God that they should be excused. And he said that he has finished his task in a sense that means he want to revive spirituality amongst the Jewish people who were really not in the spiritual line. That was the mission that with which he had come. So he thought that he has finished his mission. In that way he prayed to the Lord that I have finished your task, and on your hands actually I offer my soul. In that way actually he passed away. Now it so happened that after his passing, the sentries returned and they found that he is dead. So they are buried, and buried means there is a cave, empty cave where the body was kept, and there was a big stone that was placed there. And not only that, the priest requested the governor to put sentries there, because Jesus Christ had said that he will, after his death, after 3 days he will again come back to life. That means he will arise. So they are apprehensive that these followers of Jesus Christ will take out the body, and they will claim that he has risen. All those things will happen. So they said that make some arrangements so that the body is not stolen. So in that way, several sentries were put there. And it so happened at night, actually, there was a rumbling sound from that, from inside that cave where his body was put. And ultimately, they saw that there was some light, and Jesus Christ actually came out. And the sentries were defended, actually, by seeing him in flesh and blood. And they actually ran to the court, and then they reported that he has come back to life. So naturally people came to see him, but they did not find anybody there. And by that time, one of the disciples of Jesus Christ, Mary Magdalene, actually came there. Her intention was that, well, my teacher has passed away, so his body should be anointed properly so that the body is preserved. That was the intention. So she came to the garden, and she saw that the tomb was empty. And she was looking here and there, and in front of him, Jesus Christ appeared. But Mary Magdalene could not recognize him and said that, well, are you a gardener? So in that way, she asked, and ultimately, Jesus Christ revealed himself that, yes, I'm Jesus Christ. And then she ran to the disciples. That means disciples of Jesus Christ and told that, "I have seen him in flesh and blood." So they did not believe. So they rushed to see him. And ultimately, we see that it is like this, that they did not see him, but when they came back and they were just eating food in their in a congregation, there actually Jesus Christ appeared for a moment, and he ate with them, and ate in such a way they also did not recognize him, but the way he actually tore his bread and all those things, they could understand that this is Jesus Christ. And suddenly actually he disappeared. And amongst them there was a devotee, there was a follower of Jesus Christ, disciple of Jesus Christ. His name was Thomas. Thomas was not present when Jesus Christ appeared when they were taking meals. So they told Thomas that Jesus Christ came back, took food with us, and we recognized him. Thomas actually did not believe. So he said that if I personally see him in flesh and blood, and not only that, I shall test him. That means whether there is blood in his hands, because he was crucified. So in that way, ultimately Jesus Christ appeared before him and he tested, and then actually he believed that yes, Jesus Christ actually came back in flesh and blood. So this happened and they were overjoyed. And while going away from that, that means before he took leave of them, he said that, "Well, I shall come back again, and then I shall finally took leave of you. But in the meantime, I shall do something." That means without, don't be afraid. I shall give you some power. That means the Spirit will come to you, the Holy Spirit will come to you, and with that you will get the energy or strength to spread my message in the world. So that happened about 8 days afterwards when they were fishing. That means they were fishermen. The disciples were fishermen. So when they were fishing, so that day they did not have good catch. That means they did not find any fish. So Jesus Christ actually appeared on the shore and told that you put your nest there. And ultimately they caught plenty of fish, and then they started eating what is called frying those fish. And there actually he told that, "Well, I shall go back, go away, and energy, that means spiritual energy, enter into you, and with that you spread the message." So after that, Jesus Christ went away. That means suddenly he went away towards the sky, and from the sky there was a rumbling sound, storm, and all those things. And it is said that all the spiritual energy entered into them. So they are all overjoyed. Overjoyed in a sense, just like an intoxicated person, they started behaving, and ultimately they understood that this is the message that he has left. And in that way, they started spreading the message. So the point is this resurrection. That means it is said in the Bible, and it is the belief of what is called devout Christians, that Jesus Christ rose from his burial, that means from his death in flesh and blood, and to spread the message of resurrection. And that is a very important issue in Christianity. So this is, sometimes we think that whether it is possible, or it was just a story, or something which in those days, they were unlettered people, so they had some sort of vision or whatever it may be. So that is the interesting bone of contention. But the point is that there is a resurrection. So what is that resurrection? That is good to know. In what way, whether those that type of resurrection, that means after death something remains and that live forever, that is every religion has got that type of notion. That means something will remain after the body perishes. So whether it is physical body or whether it is soul, so all those things are interesting to know. So I have collected few, what is called, few opinions or the beliefs that are common in different religions. So I shall present that to you. Then I shall tell you the concept of resurrection. That means rebirth, if you call it, or reincarnation, if you call it, in the Vedanta thoughts. So first is that in a religion, salvation or revelation is a concept as a part of divine providence. That means why actually, how actually it can happen that somebody will be alive after death, that, or something will be there after the body perishes. So there are two concepts. That means for biological death, that means God saves people. By God's grace only that can happen. So all religions believe it is God's grace through which actually it can happen. So from biological, by providing for them of eternal life, that is a concept that yes, biological death was there, but they will be revived again after a certain time or after many, many years in the physical body they will come back. That is one concept. Another concept is from spiritual death, that means by providing divine law, illumination and judgment. That means spiritual death means that means somebody has suffered what is called spiritually, that means because of actions, what they have done or whatever it may be. So there is a rebirth, that means he will get back to the original pristine true life, to spirit, and in that way he will be saved. So the world's religion hold varying positions on the way to attain salvation and what it means. The salvation means that Christianity preaches, that means all religions have got that after death actually you will go to heaven or you will be born again or you will cross the, as it is called, that you will not be born again. That means there will be cessation of continuation of birth and death. All those things are really important to know. Now, some religions claim that salvation can be attained by using only inner human resources, such as meditation, accumulation of wisdom, asceticism, rituals, or good deeds. So you can, what is called, get liberation, salvation, that means from the cycle of birth and death, by your own effort, by doing spiritual practice according to scriptures. Of all scriptures, you'll find there are certain disciplines that, if that is followed, and you will, after death actually, you will go to heaven or you will be released from the cycle of birth and death. So that is there. Other religions teach that humans can be saved only through the grace granted by an external person, a personal agent, like bodhisattva, by the blessings, if you call it, or by the grace, you can say, of God, or a godlike person like avatars or bodhisattva, according to Buddhism, in that type of persons actually, if they are give you what is called assurance or they bless you, then actually you will get the liberation. So these are the, one is self-effort, another is grace. That is the point. So the religions of the East regard salvation as the impersonal merging with the absolute. That means salvation means, that means there will be cessation of coming birth on earth. That means there will be no physical body after the salvation. In contrast, the three largest religions of the world, Judaism, Christianity and Islam, which are known as Abrahamic religion, because they think that their forefather, that means that they came out of the their original father is Abraham, so Abrahamic religion they are called. So they associate these three religions, that means Judaism, Christianity and Islam, associate salvation with freedom from the bondage of sin and re-establishment of personal communication with the Creator. So what happens to them? That means after death and when they are saved, they will permanently live with the Creator, that means with God. That is the belief. There are some basic differences among those religions on how the sin is to be overcome by humans. So first is the, let us see, in Judaism, what is the concept? In Judaism, Judaism holds that adherents do not need personal salvation as Christians believe. Jews do not subscribe to the doctrine of original sin. That is very important to know. Original sin in Christianity, actually, we are born. That means Christians believe that they are born, and because they are born, they are full of sin. That is the concept. And instead, they place a high value of individual morality as defined in the law of God. So Jews believe that God has given a set of rules, if you call it, if they are followed, they automatically will get the salvation. That is the, in a nutshell, their concept. That means they don't need any interference of God for the salvation. That is the concept. Then in Islam, as I told you, Islam is also an Abrahamic religion. Salvation in Islam refers to the eventual entrance to heaven. That means ultimately after death, if you are really in the grace of God, or if you have lived a righteous life, you will, after death, you will go to paradise or heaven. That means permanently you will be there. And the concept of heaven or paradise that is given in the Islam book, in Quran, is that it is just like the life in world, but in not exaggerated, but in a multifarious form. That means everything is very enjoyable, life is very good, food and other things, everything is there, just the way we live on earth. So that will be permanently available in paradise after death. That is the, in nutshell, the concept. The word does not cover, that means salvation, the word does not cover the possible entry to hellfire. There is no concept of hellfire. I shall come to the hellfire because in Christianity is there. The Quran teaches that the only thing guaranteeing no salvation is a disbelief in the one God, associating others with God. That means you have to believe God is really one. There is no other. So, nobody is superior to that and nobody equal to that. So if somebody believes in that, then actually he is saved. That means after death he will go to heaven. Now, in Buddhism also, in other religions also, there is the concepts of their own concepts. That is also, I would like to share with you in a nutshell. Buddhism, liberation, called nirvana, and is seen as the end of suffering. Buddha actually discovered, as you know, when he was a young prince, he wanted to see the world, and he discovered that there is disease, there is death, and there is old age, and all those things impressed upon him that the life is full of suffering. Though there are moments of happiness, but they are very temporary. Ultimately, things boil down to suffering. So he wanted to discover if there is any end of suffering, and that he discovered, that means through meditation, when he attained to nirvana, that was then the sufferings ended. And he preached that. So liberation, called nirvana in Buddhism, is seen as an end to suffering, an end to suffering, rebirth, and ignorance. Rebirth means Buddhists also believe in the rebirth. In the three Abrahamic religion, there is no rebirth. That means Christians or Muslims or Jewish people are not born again as a human being. Permanently they go to heaven. Or they go to, according to Christianity, they may go to hell or something like that, but they are not born on earth. And Buddhism, Lord Buddha taught that the Four Noble Truths are the basis. If somebody follows the Four Noble Truths, actually, there will be the end of suffering. And amongst the Four Noble Truths, there is an Eightfold Path also. That means it is a set of disciplines, if somebody follows, he will attain nirvana. So according to the Buddhist practice, the ultimate goal is salvation, or in Sanskrit word, moksha nirvana. That is the permanent cessation of all sufferings. And as you know, the present Dalai Lama is very well-known teacher. Teacher in a sense that he is considered to be by the followers of the supreme representative or teacher of the Buddhism at the present age. So Dalai Lama believes, despite the differences which may appear on the suffering of the world's greatest religion, that they all share the common goal of pursuit of happiness for their adherents. That means pursuit of happiness. That means how we can attain a permanent happiness. That is ultimately, it is saying in another way, that cessation of the suffering that is being said. And there is another religion which is known as Jainism, and they have not too many following, but it is very important, very ancient religion also. It is almost, it is ancient in a sense that it is almost as ancient as Hinduism, definitely older than Buddhism also. So in Jainism, the word moksha is there. That means liberation is there. It is salvation or emancipation of the soul, individual soul, that they believe that there is a soul inside the body. That means body, beyond the body and mind, the soul is there. And it is a blissful state of existence of a soul completely free from karmic bondage. That means if somebody attains to salvation, so it will be free. That means there is no bondage in him. And free from samsara. Samsara means repeated coming to the birth and death. The cycle of birth and death. The liberated soul is said to have attained its true and pristine nature of infinite bliss, infinite knowledge and infinite perception. So if somebody attains this moksha, nirvana, he will be free from the ignorance, from suffering, and all those things will be gone for him. Such a soul is called siddha and considered as supreme soul or God. That means that person who will attend to that, he is called God. That means in Jainism, it is they are non-believer of God. That means they do not believe in the existence of God, but they believe in the liberation of the individual soul. So as it has been said, that by practice of discipline, one can attain and realize the true self, and in that way it happens. So it is the highest, and that means in Jainism, these siddhas those who are equivalent to God, they call them as God. It is the highest and noblest objective that a soul should strive to achieve. So it is the highest aim of a human life, and they try to achieve that. So there is a description of in Jain scripture. They say, what is nirvana? Where there is neither pain nor pleasure, neither suffering nor obstacle, neither birth nor death, there is the moksha, that means emancipation. Where there is neither sense organs, nor surprise, nor sleep, nor thirst, nor hunger, and that is called moksha, liberation. Where there is neither karma, nor the worries of karma, nor any type of thinking, that is called nirvana. So in that way, the ultimate state of nirvana has been described in the scriptures. And according to Jainism, liberation can be attained only in the human birth. That is also interesting to know, that you have to have human birth, and in animal birth, or there are other births, that means there are animals, subhuman beings and other creatures, they are there. They cannot have liberation. So in that way, one has to have human birth to attain to liberation. Then there is another religion, Sikhism, which we encounter time to time. It is also, that religion also originated, and it was started by Guru Nanak. And they are very large and important following also. And in Sikhism, it is like this. It is more or less a Hindu concept to which I shall come. It is like this: salvation in Sikhism means ending the cycle of death and birth, and thus merging oneself with the infinite formless God. In Sikhism, they do not believe in the form of God. That means they believe in formless God. And according to Guru Nanak, the founder of Sikhism, the goal of human is to have union with God, and for this Sikhs are to conquer their ego, and thus realizing their true nature, which is the same as God. So what are their practices? So they say these are the practices according to the scripture. Dharam khan, that means the realm of righteous action. That means if the actions are right, then it will progress in towards liberation. Gyan khan, that means a realm of knowledge. So with work actually, one should have the spiritual knowledge also. That will lead to the goal. Then the realm of spiritual endeavor, some spiritual practices like meditation or devotional practices, all those things also needed to be done. And then also a realm of grace, that means prayer and meditation, which actually invoke the grace of God, that also needs to be done. And also a realm of truth, that means you have to adhere to truthfulness. So these are the practices that are recommended for a true Sikh, for the attainment of liberation. So it is more or less like Hinduism, you see. But it is also important to know that in Sikhism, they also believe that without human birth, you cannot have liberation. That is understandable because in human birth only you can have knowledge and such other things. That is the point. Now let me come to our Hinduism. What is the concept of liberation in Hinduism? In Hinduism, salvation of Atman or liberation from samsara, the cycle of death and rebirth attainment of the highest spiritual state. That means the attainment of what is called salvation of the Atman, liberation of Atman, and what is called going out of the samsara life, birth, cycle of birth and death. That is the goal of the liberation. That means moksha, as it is called. And even the hell and heaven are really temporary. You see, that means in Abrahamic religion there is the concept of heaven, and of course in Islam there is no concept of hell as such, and also in Judaism there is a concept of paradise and where you live. So the point is this: Hindus believe, or according to Vedantic scriptures, this staying in the hell or heaven are really temporary. It is like this: they believe in the cycle of karma. That is very important. Nowadays, of course, all religions are believing into karma, because we see in practical life you get the result of what you are doing. But it is very much extended in Hinduism in this way. That means you are born because of your past actions. The way you are born, the place you are born, or with the nature that you are born, all those things actually have come because the result of your past karmas. That means the karmas that you have done in your previous lives. And again, what you are doing, the result you will reap in the next life. In that way, things are really continuing. So the cessation of this karmic cycle is the liberation. And naturally, there are different teachers and different what is called incarnations. They have time to time taught in what way to attain that. So this is the point, that even the staying in the hell and heaven are temporary. It is said that because of bad karma, you stay in hell. That means you will go to hell after your death. And if you have done good karma, charity, or you have helped people, compassionate, you have shown compassion, serve people, and all those things, so naturally you will go to heaven. So good karma will take you to heaven, bad karma will take you to hell. Now the point is that there is always bone of contention whether there is a place, just like earth, there is another planet, or whether there is another region which is designated as hell or heaven. But in general, logically, it seems that it is the same as the next birth. That means you are born in heaven, or you'll enjoy your good life in heaven. Like that means when will you be born after good deeds? If you have not attained to liberation, then you will be born again. But this birth will be a good birth in a sense. Probably you will be born in a very prosperous family, as Lord Krishna has said in Bhagavad Gita. That means in the house of religious people or good people, what is called noble souls will be born. So that is the enjoyment of what is called heaven, we can call it. That means everything will be ready for enjoyment and smooth and shining and all those things. And hell means that probably you will be born in a very constant circumstances. So suffering and all those things will come from the very birth. So that is another way of explaining the existence of heaven and hell. And the point is this reasoning is good in a sense. That means there also you get a chance to work out your karma. So then again, if the good senses come, so if you are suffering, so good senses come, you start doing good work. So naturally then it is possible that you again have the possibility of getting liberation. And in heaven also it is like this. If you really understand that this enjoyments and all those things that are being that is being enjoyed, that is not permanent, and then one takes to the life of spirituality, discipline, and all those things, then in that life also it is possible to have the liberation. So this is the difference, you can call it, that in Hinduism also it is said that one can have liberation in the human birth. That means to get liberation, one has to be born as a human being. That is also there. Of course, we see that in Puranas and other places you may find, but by the blessings of a certain god, that means Hindus have different concepts of gods. God, though ultimately it is one, but there are many forms that what is called the seekers have found in that way. There are many forms. So we find by the grace of different gods and goddesses, even subhuman beings also attain to liberation or have the great spiritual unfoldment. That is there. But ultimately, in general, we can say human birth is most important. Shankaracharya has said that human birth is the only birth where one can do their karma and attain to liberation. So moksha is the final, is continuing Hinduism's concept. Moksha is a final release from one's worldly conception of self and loosening of the shackles of experiential duality and re-establishment in one's own fundamental nature. Though the nature is seen as ineffable and beyond sensation, the actual state is seen differently. Actually, there is different concepts of liberation also. So that means in Advaitic concept it is like this. That means you will become one of the ultimate reality. Ultimate realities means the which is really existing. That means we have forgotten or we superimpose different things on that reality, and in that way our ignorance is there. So when the ignorance is gone, we know our true nature. That means we are that ultimate reality, and that is the moksha. But there are other schools of thoughts in Hinduism also. They say that yes, there are godheads, different godheads are there. You have worshipped that, and after death actually we live with that. And ultimately that is their liberation. That means when those gods and goddesses, that means it is said that after the cycle of this creation, the gods and goddesses that are they are also temporary, because heaven and hell are temporary. So when they merge into the what is called ultimate reality, with them they also get liberation. So that is the concept of those who are dualist. So the ultimate, the what is called according to the Upanishad, that means the greatest scriptures of Hindus, these Upanishads, one who realizes the ultimate true self will become one with the ultimate reality. So he will not be born again, and the sufferings will go away. Brahman, through practice of yoga, Hinduism recognizes several paths to achieve this goal, none of which is exclusive. The paths are the way of selfless work, karma yoga, or the self-dissolving love, that means bhakti yoga, or absolute discernment and knowledge, jnana yoga, and royal meditative immersion, raja yoga. Raja yoga, those who nowadays, a lot of people are really attracted to raja yoga, that means path of meditation that we see. The point is this: it is a what is called the primary what is called primary practice is the self effort. That means it is by self effort one can have the self realization. So it is that means practice is within our own it is in our capacity. So those who are really very sincere and they think they confident that I can do this, so they follow the path of meditation. But there are others who actually, through other paths, like a practice of devotion or practice of selfless action, there are instances that they have also reached the ultimate goal, liberation. Now, just to cite a few of the how it has been illustrated, or it has been said in a scripture that ultimately the liberation brings the ultimate joy, if you call it happiness. And liberation brings the end of the cycle of birth and death. All those things have been said. So I would like to share some of the quotes from the scriptures. This is from the Bhagavad Gita. So he is saying, Lord Krishna, as you know, it is a teaching of Lord Krishna to Arjuna, and there are many spiritual truths that he had taught him. So there he has said, this is a very well-known verse, Vasaṃsi jirnāni yathā vihāyo navāni grinhāti naropurāni tatha sharirani vihāyo jirnānāni saṅjāti navāni dehi. So it is a concept that means human beings or all beings are born again and again, quitting their body, that is being said. So even as a person casts worn out clothes and puts on others that are new, so the embodied self casts off worn out bodies and enters into others that are new. So in that way, cyclically, it is continuing that we see that it, in our scriptures it has been said. Lord Krishna has said in Bhagavad Gita, which are in a nutshell taken from the our Upanishad scripture. So in that way it has been said. So the point is that that our body will be cast, and if we are not really get liberation, it will be born again. It is true for all beings. Then in the Upanishads there is the saying, Srinnantu Vishe Amritasya Putra Aye Dhamani Dibbani Tostu Vedahometam Purushang Mahantam Aditya Varnam Tamasa Parastar Tameva Viditva Otimrittumeti Nanna Pantha Vidyatavayana. This is the supreme truth of the scriptures. That means in a nutshell that has been said. Hear, O children of immortality. That means a sage, if you call it, is declaring. That means after attaining the what is called the moksha, he is declaring. Even those who dwell in the celestial worlds, I have realized the great effulgent spirit beyond the darkness of ignorance. Knowing him alone does one overcome death and become immortal. There is no other way. So self-realization is the ultimate goal of spirituality. Somehow or other, if somebody can attain to that, actually he or she will be free from rebirth and also attain to immortality. Now the point is that in Christianity we always say, and sometimes we what is called those who are irrational, they think how it is possible that you will be born again in flesh and blood at the end of the cycle or at a long distant past when the body is buried inside the earth. What do you mean by that? But you see, it is a sort of probably a little bit from the very beginning, the concept of liberation of the soul, that means the teaching that Lord Jesus Christ had lived, that he will meet or they will come to him and live with God or with him forever, that concept was not from the point of view of physical body. That has been taught in the early days also. Saint Paul, as you know, he is considered to be the one of the greatest preacher of Christianity, or one of the ancient, not only ancient, probably he is considered to be the primary source of preaching of Christianity. That means he actually put life to Christianity. That means during his time, actually Christianity spread like anything. So he has he used to write, that means they used to travel and preach. So time to time they used to have correspondences, as you know. That means some doubts came to some Christian or some teacher whom he had appointed there. So he clarified this point in this way. So he is saying, in the New Testament, St. Paul has given another meaning of resurrection. That is important to know. In his first letter to the Corinthians, we read, that means you'll find in the new what is called in the letters to Corinthians, but some men will say, how are the dead raised up, and what body do they come? Thou fool, that means it is his language I am using, thou fool, that which thou sowest is not quickened except it die. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of man, another flesh of beast, another of fishes, and another of birds. There are also celestial bodies and bodies terrestrial, but the glory of the celestial is one and the glory of the terrestrial is another. So also is the resurrection of the dead. It is sown in corruption and it is raised in incorruption. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. There is a natural body and there is a spiritual body. So you see, in ancient times also it was emphasized, the resurrection means not the physical body but the celestial body, that means the spirit. That means, as I told you, in Hinduism there is the concept, that means one will reside with God forever, those who are dualists. So in the same way in Christianity it seems that it is like dualism, definitely it is dualism, and they will live That means after the body is cremated, or when the devout person will reach paradise or heaven, and they will stay for some time, if you call it, and then ultimately, when there will be cessation of this creation, they will be liberated with the spiritual entity, that means with Jesus Christ, and they will be merged into God. So that concept was prevalent, but we see that is not emphasized. Or there is a school who actually definitely emphasize that, but in general it is like this. And we did not really think that it is possible to be immortal in physical body. That is really all religions, no religion will teach that. So it is the spirituality, the spirit that is within ourselves, that can become immortal by getting rid of the physical body, by doing spiritual practices.